2 Peter chapter 1, and I'll read from verse 3 and verse 4. That is where our message comes from. Peter, as he is writing to the people scattered all over, he says that God's, from verse 3, God's divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us by glory and virtue, by which have been given to us exceedingly great and precious promises. Father, in Jesus' name, I commit this word to you and I commit myself to you, even as we begin to share that which you have given to us. In Jesus' name, I have prayed.
Amen.
Amen. Today's message comes from the title in your program. And as someone commented, today's title of this message is Stop Eating Crackers. Stop Eating Crackers. And there is a picture of crackers there. But the title is Stop Eating Crackers. We are going to discover in a minute what crackers we are talking about. So, from the letter of 2 Peter, chapter 1, 2 to 4, there are two things that I am going to talk about. Then it will explain to us what we mean by stopping eating crackers. Now, as far as God is concerned, and as far as you and me are concerned as believers, there is one thing we must be sure of, that God always makes provisions first. Before he can do anything, before he even sends anybody anywhere, first he makes provisions. That is the fact we need to get hold of. In other words, God does not just send us and we find there is nothing there. He makes provisions first. So should the Lord send you, you don't worry about provisions. He will provide. You remember the story of Abraham and Isaac? As Isaac asked Abraham, we have the wood and we have the fire, but where is the sacrifice? Where is the goat? Where is the lamb to be sacrificed? And the father replied and said, on the mountain of the Lord it shall be seen. In other words, the Lord shall provide. So there are times the Lord may call you to do things, but I want you to know today that first he makes provisions. Let's go back to the time of Adam and Eve. When God created Adam and Eve, the first thing God did was to create the Garden of Eden. And the Bible says he put Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. Now think about the Garden of Eden. Nothing was lacking. Everything was available. And God put Abraham in a prepared garden where he had made all provisions. Now, believe it or not, God has made provisions for every believer in advance. And this will be the main topic. Just like he made provisions for Adam and Eve in the form of the Garden of Eden, where everything was available, he has done exactly the same thing with us believers. In the book of 2 Peter, where we have just read chapter 1 and verse 3. Listen to what the word of God says. It says that God, through his divine power in verse 3, has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness. What is he talking about? Peter is saying that God has already provided everything pertaining to this life we live and also to godliness. What he is saying is that God has already made provisions both for the physical things we need and for the spiritual things we need. Just like the Garden of Eden, God has already prepared everything that we need for this life and for godliness. This is a fact we need to grasp, because our prayers will have to change. We must know that God has already made provisions. Now imagine Adam, he was given the right to eat every fruit of the garden except one. Do you remember anywhere in the Bible, Adam going to ask God, can I eat that one? Or can I eat that one? He was free. He was told, you are free to eat all the fruits except one. Now, how would you expect Adam then to go back to God and ask for permission to eat a certain fruit? He already was given the freedom to eat all the other things. In the same way, the Spirit of God is saying today, I have given you all provisions for this life and also for the life to come. In other words, both physical life and spiritual life, the Spirit of God says, everything is given. Notice, Peter says, he has given to us all things. It is not some things, it is all things. They have been given to us. That's what Peter is telling us. And that is what the Spirit of God wants us to receive today, that he has given us all things. The only thing we need to do, every believer then, we must go in and possess what has been given to us. Let's look at the story of Israel. God promised Abraham a long time ago, I am taking you to the promised land. And he told the Israelites, I am bringing you from Egypt to the promised land, a land that is flowing with milk and honey. That was the promise that was given. Now, the land of Canaan was already there. The fruits, the honey, and the milk, they were already flowing. So when Israel were told, I am taking you to a land that is very rich, very fertile. It flows with honey and milk. It was already flowing with honey and milk. In other words, Israel came to a prepared land, the land of promises. In other words, God did not wait until Israel entered into the promised land and then he began to provide. No, he prepared the land before the Israelites entered into the land. You know, we believers, we have not yet understood that everything is ready. Everything has been prepared for this life and for godliness. In the book of Matthew 22, there is a very interesting parable of a king who prepared a wedding feast. And after the wedding feast was prepared, he began to invite people. And he sent his messengers to invite people, and this was the invitation, come and eat. But they did not respond. But afterwards, he sent the messengers again, and he told them, go and urge them to come. Tell them, this is what is interesting, tell them, I have made everything ready. And you know, in a wedding, there are goodies there. You find all sorts of foods. And the king was saying, everything is ready. Come and dine. Hear the word of the Lord today. The Lord is inviting you to come and dine. The Lord is saying, I have prepared everything. The dinner is ready. And many of us, including myself, we have not yet realized that God is inviting us to a luxurious dinner, but we are still eating crackers. No wonder these crackers appear here. This is what you have been eating spiritually. And this idea of eating crackers, it comes from a story of a man who was given a free cruise. Everything was paid for this guy. But when the day came for the cruise, he carried several crackers because he was not wealthy. Now, during the time of lunch or breakfast or supper, this man would sit at a corner and he would hide and eat his crackers there. But one day, someone passed by at lunchtime and he asked this man, I noticed you don't come for lunch. I have not seen you during dinner and I never see you in breakfast. Why are you sitting here and you are just eating crackers? The man said, well, I have not paid for the food. I didn't pay for the breakfast and lunch and dinner. And he was told, no, that is already paid for. All these days he was eating crackers and the real dinner was going on. Now, that is what we have been doing. We have been eating only crackers. And the Lord is saying, come and dine. Stop eating crackers only. Come and eat real food. Everything is made ready. Therefore, when you go to Joshua chapter 13, the first reading, the very first verse, God is speaking to Joshua. And he tells Joshua this, you are very old, but there is so much land still unpossessed. Who is listening to this message? I tell you by the word of the Lord, there is a lot of land still not yet possessed by you. And this land is waiting to be possessed by you. Dinner is ready and everything is ready, but you are still there eating crackers. So this message is about possessing the land that is still remaining unpossessed. You will be amazed at how much land is remaining unpossessed in your case and in my case. We have not yet even begun. We are still outside there. We are still eating these crackers. Yet there is a full dinner that is waiting for us. There is a full lunch that is waiting for us. But we have not moved. We are still eating crackers. It is time, says the Spirit of the Lord, to go in and possess the land that still remains unpossessed. You look at your life and you will know there are many things you have not yet possessed. And yet, Peter says, all things have been given free. They are already given. So it is for you and me to go in and possess. So this message is about possessing the unpossessed land in your case and in my case. Now, what is this unpossessed land? Because it is not physical land. Remember, the promise to Israel was for a promised land. And God fulfilled that promise and he brought them into the land. And in the book of Joshua, we see God telling Joshua, hey, there is still so much. You need to go in and possess. Now, that is done. That is history. They have occupied the promised land. But for you and me as a believer, we are not entering the promised land. That is not what God is telling us. For you and me as a believer, God is calling us into a land of promises. Hallelujah. It is not the land, but it is a land of promises. He wants us to enter into these promises. So when we talk about land that is unpossessed, we are talking about what God has provided for you and for me, all the provisions, and we have not yet entered to take hold of those provisions. Now, these provisions, according to Peter, they are given in the promises of God. Let's look at verse 4. Verse 4 says that these have been given to us through exceedingly great and precious promises. Let's see what Peter is saying. These are great and precious promises, gracious promises. They are gracious because they are free. It's from the word grace. They are great because they contain everything that we need. So what is our land that we have not yet possessed? It consists of all the promises we have not yet taken hold of. That is what the Lord is calling us to do. There is so much to be possessed. So we have been given these promises, and Peter says they are great and gracious promises. Now the question is, we are still far below the promises that have been given. We are still eating our crackers. So the question we will answer today by the grace of God is this: how do we go in and possess the promises that are freely given? Remember, Peter is saying that they are great and gracious promises. And then he says, everything pertaining to this life and godliness has been given. Everything, all things have been given through the promises. Now, how do we go in and begin to take hold of these promises? In other words, how do we stop eating crackers? How are we going to know that a full dinner is ready, that a full lunch is ready, that a full breakfast is ready? When are we going to stop eating crackers only? When are we going to learn to go in and eat everything the Lord has prepared for us? How do we then possess the promises? Now, there are various things that we need to do in order to possess the promises, because I know that is the question in your mind. There are many promises, and some of you are holding on to some promises. But we need to know, how do I go in? I know I have been invited, because the invitation is to everybody who is willing to come. But how do we then go in to get hold of these promises? Because these promises represent the land we have not yet possessed. And the Bible says there is too much land still unpossessed. There are too many promises still unpossessed, unclaimed by the believers, yet they are free. The first thing we need to do in order to get hold of these promises is to know the promises. Like this guy who was eating crackers, he was not aware that his dinner, his lunch, his breakfast, they were all included in the package. That is where many believers, we are going wrong. We have not yet known that the full package has been provided. We have not yet known that everything has been given. We have not yet understood that great and gracious promises have been given. So the first thing is to know that there are promises. Which leads me then to the next thing. We need to learn from the Word of God what promises are given here in the Word of God. Amen. Do you know why the enemy fights us so hard when it comes to reading the Word of God? When it comes to going to Bible study? Do you know why he fights so hard? Do you know why he stops us from coming to church? Because it is in the church when you will learn, where you will learn. What are these promises? It is in the Bible that you will learn all the promises that have been given. So the first thing, the very first step, is to know that there are promises and to know where they are and what do they say. What do these promises say? Because you cannot go into a land and possess it and you don't know whether the land is available. We got to know that the promises are available. Today we know that they have been available. They have been made available to every believer. Because Peter says, everything has been given pertaining to this life and godliness. So that is the first thing, the knowledge of the promises. How many promises do you know in the Word of God? It is written by some people that we have over 800 promises of God. If there are so many promises, and we are still only know one or two or three promises, there is no comparison between three promises and 800 promises. Therefore, if you only know a few promises, let us assume that we have advanced a little bit and we know 10 promises. Even if we know 10 promises, then you still have 770, over 770 promises still unclaimed. So there is a lot of land unclaimed by believers. If you are a believer seated here and you only know a few promises, it is time for you to learn what are these promises. And then you begin to walk in them. The trouble is, many of us don't know the promises. There are some people in this place, this place you are seated and those who are listening, we are struggling because we don't know there are promises. It is like this guy who was eating crackers. He did not know that everything was provided. And many believers today, they don't know that everything is provided. So we are still struggling. We work very hard, we sweat. And yet, God has said, I have promised, I will provide for you. Look at Abraham. He did not struggle at all to attain wealth. He simply said, God is going to provide. And Jesus is our provider. He provides everything. He says, seek first the kingdom of God, and all these other things shall be added unto you. All these other things, they shall be added unto you. So the question is, why am I struggling? Why am I struggling to get enough income? Why am I struggling to buy a house? Why am I struggling to buy a car? There has to be something that I am not doing. And in most cases, it is because we do not know the promises. We only know 10. We don't know, for example, many people don't know the promise that says silver and gold belong to me. The earth and its fullness belong to me. If I don't know that, then how can I claim that which God has given to me? Because God says, I have given you everything. So it is lack of knowledge that is making many people to struggle physically in this life. Yet, there are promises still waiting. We need to wake up and go in and possess the promises, but we must know what are these promises. The second thing is this. Once you know the promises, you must claim them. You must say, this belongs to me. I will stand on this promise. There is a story of someone who got hold of the Bible and she had read a lot of promises and she said, I am going to stand physically on the Bible and I am going to claim all those promises I have read about. So she stood on the Bible. So now we know the promises. We have to read the promises. We have to study the Word of God. And then we have to begin to claim them. I gave you a testimony about the job I wanted so much as a chaplain. But after the interview, they wrote a letter saying they have taken somebody else. But the question is, were we holding on to something? Were we aware of the promises of God? Yes, we were aware. We were aware that one day, a long time ago, one king, Zedekiah, he got a letter from the Syrians threatening him and saying, I am going to finish your country. You don't have the strength to defend yourself, so you give up. And this man, this king of Israel, he took the letter, he brought it to the temple, he laid it out, and he told the Lord from heaven, look at this letter from this king of Syria. He has threatened us, and he is right. We cannot defend ourselves, but I'm calling upon you to defend us. We remembered that God responded and said, you, because you have called me, and because this king is arrogant, and he is prideful, I am going to fight for you. In the same way, we took the letter that was written to me saying we have taken someone else. We laid it out before the Lord. And like this king, we told the Lord, Lord, you said we can possess the land. Hallelujah. We can go in and possess the land. So we said, we will wait until you tell us that we are possessing the land. It took only a few months. They wrote another letter. And they said, the person we took has quit. So can you come? So I went in to possess the land. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. So we must learn to claim the promises. And claiming is again an area where many of us believers, we are failing. We fail to hold on to the promise no matter what. So it brings me to the third step of how to enter and take hold of the land that still remains unpossessed. To take hold of the promises, the provisions God has made for us. This step is abiding within the conditions in the promise. Many people, we read the promises of God, but we always forget to read the conditions. Every time there is a promise, there is a condition, and we must learn to abide within that condition. Look at Adam. He was given everything, but he was told, don't touch that particular tree in the center of the garden, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Don't touch it. Don't eat it. The day you will eat, you are surely going to die. That was the only condition. But you know the story, he disobeyed. And once he broke the law, he was kicked out of the promises of God. He never enjoyed again the goodness of Eden. We have therefore to learn, when you get hold of a promise, what is the condition? What does the Lord require me to do in this particular promise? Once you know that, you are on your way to possessing the promises that still remain to be possessed. Which then brings me to the issue of obedience. This is where, brethren, we have failed. We fail to be obedient. Unless we obey what the Lord is telling us, we will not experience the promises God has given to us. So we have to learn to walk by faith and not by sight. The promises of God, sometimes when you start holding on to them and you are fulfilling the conditions, did you know that sometimes you don't see anything? It takes some years. You are not seeing even a ray of light. But that is when it is necessary to say, God has said it, and I do not need to see anything with my eyes. I will walk by faith. That is a very important step. When we decide, Lord, I really don't see anything. It's like the time Israel came to the Red Sea. And the Israelites, they looked at the Red Sea, and they looked at the Egyptians behind them, and they said, we are finished. We are cornered. And there is one particular leader who rose up against Moses. And this is what he said. Is this where this man is leading us? Is this where God is leading us? Look at the sea. Where are you going? Is he leading us into the sea? Now, that is where walking by faith comes in. Because if you can remember what I taught you about the work of the devil, the devil will come and he will use somebody. And that somebody is going to show you, where are you going? There is only the sea. How are you going to walk and there is no path? That's what the enemy is going to tell you. How do you think you are going to make it and you are not as educated as so and so? How do you think you are going to succeed and others have failed? Don't you see there is no way here? Don't you see there is no path? Satan's work is to deceive. He is a liar. He is an accuser. And he thwarts us. He stops us all the time. So you have to remember that as we walk by faith, do not depend on sight, because the devil will come and he'll begin to tell you there is no path there. You can see it's only water, like this leader who was opposing Moses. He was saying, is God going to lead you into the sea? Is that the promised land? But we have to remember that God is God.
Amen.
Did he not make a path in the Red Sea?
Yes.
So where was the devil to tell the people there is no path? There is a path. Sometimes you don't see it. You may just see the water. You may just see the Red Sea and you decide there is no way out. That is the lie of the devil. Hold on to the promise of God. That is where we need to say no. We must learn to hold on and walk by faith, not by sight, not what we are seeing. Sometimes in your place of work, things can turn out to be very, very difficult. But the Lord may have told you, I am going to raise you up in this company. I am going to promote you here. But when you look at the opposition, the enemy begins to tell you, so who do you think you are? Do you think you are going to bypass these guys? They have been here for years. They are very experienced. They are more qualified than you. Now, those are the things that you say, I do not walk by sight. I walk by faith. I hold on to the word of God and say, Lord, I don't see any path. But I know that you can make a path where there is no path. Is that not what we sing? He makes a way where it seems there is no way. But the devil is going to concentrate on the fact that there is no way. So there is something then we need to do if we are going to possess the promises that are still so many. We must learn to persevere. We must learn to say, no matter how rough it is for me,
amen,
I am going to stand on these promises. Hallelujah.
Amen.
You do not know how we were fought before we came to America. Everything was against us. Everything was so much against us. There were times when we were shedding tears. But we held on to a word that was given to us a long time ago. We held on to it and we persevered. We said, we are not moving. We are going to see whose God is God.
Amen.
I always tell my wife, when we run into issues, I tell her, wait, let's see whose God is God.
Amen.
So we held on and eventually we got victory. That is why we are here today. Because we held on, we persevered. Because we have to persevere, because we have an enemy who is fighting us. Secondly, we must learn to stand our ground.
Amen.
There is a time to stand and say, no, I am standing. I am standing on the word of God. Devil, you cannot move me. You cannot persuade me otherwise. I will stand on the word of God. The word of God is a rock. You can stand on it. It is faithful from everlasting to everlasting.
Amen.
It is more solid than the mountains you see with the eyes. So you decide, no matter what is happening, I am going to stand. There are people here, and those who may be listening to this message, you have been struggling, and yet you know that God has promised. What I'm telling you today by the Spirit of God is stand and see the salvation of the Lord.
Yeah.
Just stand firm. Believe the word that has been given to you. Believe the word that you have read and stand on it. Finally, we have to learn to resist, because the enemy is going to push us. Remember, his work is to block us. So he will try to block us with anything he has. Not move, not by your strength, but by the strength of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
In other words, to enter into the unclaimed land, God was talking about to Joshua. Joshua and his people, they had to fight.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
This is something I don't want you to ever forget, that just because God promised Israel that I'm taking you to the promised land, it did not come easy. Do you remember the battles that were fought?
Yes.
You read the story again. Even when they were defeating Jericho, they had to march. How many times?
13
times. That's the correct answer. Not 7 times. 13. You're going to read it again. Because the last day they had to do it, sort of all over again. So they had to walk around the city 13 times. Now, that is not easy. But that is what these promises are all about. We must resist the temptation to say, I am tired. We must resist the temptation to say, I am giving up. I don't know who is giving up here. I don't know how long you have been telling God, how long is this thing going to go on? The word of the Lord today is, do not give up. Resist. Resist the temptation to say, I am done. Resist the temptation to say, I cannot make it. That is not from the Lord. That is the work of the devil. He makes us feel like we will not make it. But by the grace of God, when we stand our ground, we will make it. But we must remember, all the promises, they are over 800. You cannot get them without fighting. It is all about fighting. Indeed, the key word, if I can summarize everything, is this: obedience to the Spirit of God.
Amen.
If you are obedient, let me tell you, no matter what storms you are going to experience, even if the whole earth is flooding, if you are living in obedience, you are going to come out victorious. This is the way I put it in my mind. When you hold on to the promises of God and you live in obedience, you are like an inflated balloon. And you know, an inflated balloon, you try to submerge it under a flood. Try to put an inflated balloon underwater. What happens? It will always bob up. Let me tell you, that is you.
Amen.
Every child of God who holds on to the promise of God and says, I am not going to be moved, I stand my ground, and I'm going to be obedient, you are that balloon.
Amen.
It doesn't mean that there is not going to be any storm. It doesn't mean there is not going to be a flood of water. But it means this: The flood cannot submerge you.
Amen.
You will always come up. Oh, hallelujah.
Amen.
You will always come up.
Yes,
yes, the world may look at you
mm-hmm.
and think that this guy is finished. Indeed, there was a time when we were fought so hard that the Lord revealed to us, and he said this, and remember this word the other day because it's a long time ago. He said, we were given a dream, and the dream was of a coffin, but we were not permitted to see who was inside the coffin. But when the Lord interpreted to us what the dream was about, he says, you are the people who are in the coffin. Because the enemy thinks he has finished you. That this is your end, you are finished. But you are not yet finished. God is way above a coffin, even if they seal it.
Yes.
He will simply command the coffin to open up. And we still come up. That is how we are here. So we do not give up, but there is fighting, brethren. If you have been fighting, there are people who have been fighting issues for a long time, and you are not seeing any victory. This is your word today. Keep on fighting. Keep on standing. Sooner than you expect, the walls of Jericho are coming down. You are entering into victory. Therefore, let us begin to move on
yes.
to possess
the
so many unpromised, unclaimed promises. Let us go in to possess the land.
Amen.
Please tell yourself, there is so much land still unpossessed by me. And today the Spirit of God is saying, it is for you to possess.
Amen.
Will you then learn the promises? Will you learn to be obedient? Will you learn to walk after the Spirit? Will you learn to walk by faith, not by sight? Do not look at the circumstances. There are people who are looking at very difficult circumstances, and they are saying, this case, it's a gone case. In the eyes of God, there is nothing gone. Nothing is impossible. He brings to life that which appears to be dead in the eyes of human beings.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe you are dealing with a relative, and the case of that relative appears to be a gone case. Today, I declare by the word of the Lord, it is not a gone case.
Amen.
Victory lies ahead if you hold on. Don't look at the circumstances. You fix your eye on the Lord Jesus Christ. He is able to see us through. He is our captain. He is our general. He holds everything. He is the good shepherd. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Let's bow our heads and pray. And before I pray, I want to ask if you have any need, please raise up your hand. I will bring your need before the Lord. If you have any need, just raise up your hand. I will present that need before the Lord. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I want to thank you for your presence in this place. I want to lift up the needs of the people, my Father, for you know what they have been fighting. The fight of faith goes on and on. There are people who are feeling defeated by circumstances. They do not see a way across the ocean. But just like you made a way through the Red Sea, Spirit of God, you are declaring today, you will make a way. I therefore lift up every need and bring it to you, that Lord, you will open a way. Where things have been impossible, Father, begin to instill a new faith in those who have almost lost their faith. Begin to increase their trust that you will see them through, no matter how difficult the situation appears to be. Yes, Lord, there is so much land still unpossessed. We have been eating crackers for many, many years. We are tired of eating crackers. We want to come. We want to accept your invitation for dinner, for lunch, for breakfast. That everything has been made ready. Oh, teach us to be obedient to you so that we can enter into the promises that you have so graciously given to each one of us, oh God. I lift up your people, my Father, as we prepare to leave this place. Lord, I lift up every believer, even those who are watching this by video, that, Lord, this week will be a very unique week. It will be a week in which many will enter into the victory they have been waiting for. Many will enter into the promises they have been holding on to for so long, O God. Begin to do new things, therefore, this week in the life of every member who is here and those who are watching this by video. I release the blessings of God Almighty to follow and to overtake your people, O God. Good Shepherd, I'm handing over your people into your care. Throughout this week, guide your people. Shepherd them, my Father. There are so many dangers. There are so many weapons being formed against those who believe in you. But today I'm asking that you will shelter your people. You will raise up a standard against the flood that the enemy raises against your people. Lord, I'm speaking victory to everyone who is hearing me today. So this week, I declare, will be a great week of victory for the families who are gathered here and those who are watching this by video. I hand over your people into your care, shelter them from accidents and from any harm that the enemy has planned against them. I release a blessing upon the children, all of them here, and the children of those who are watching this by video. I release a blessing upon them from the throne of grace. Lord, we release ourselves into your care and into your hand. Go with us, O Lord. Spirit of God, do not leave us on our own this week, but stay with us, O Lord. Let the anointing that is here continue to settle on us throughout this week. We thank you, we bless you. It is in Jesus' name I have prayed, and the people of God say,
Amen.
Amen.